Hi everyone and welcome to yet another video. For today I have a Lenovo ThinkCentre M91p which I will completely disassemble, reassemble and then, at least if it still works, perform some benchmarks on. While doing so, as I usually do here, I'll also upgrade the machine and I'll be increasing the memory and installing an SSD. The M91p might look familiar to you and I did cover it before in the tower version instead. For this video, I have the SFF or small form factor version of this machine. I did also use the same to build a home NAS some time ago. The machine type of the one I have is 7033W93. Looking up the serial number strangely shows a picture of the tower version and also that it's out of warranty for some time now. Totally as expected, of course. It looks like it was purchased somewhere around December 2011. Interesting as well is that it originally shipped to Sweden while I got it in Belgium. The configuration is still largely original with an i5-2500 as CPU and 4GB of RAM currently. Let us start by having a look at the outside of this PC. I do see on the video that the case is rather dusty, although it didn't really look like that in reality. Apologies for that. The front side has a full-size DVD writer, power button, LEDs for disk and power, two USB ports and audio. As the orientation of the text indicates, you can also use the device standing up, like it would be a small tower. As you can see, it has rubber feet on the side for this and also on the bottom. The back shows us the 240 watt power supply and power connector, serial port, VGA, DisplayPort, 6 more USB ports, Ethernet, audio and a second serial port. Opening up the machine is very easy. You can simply slide this bluish switch to the side, then you can open up the hinged cover, almost like the hood of a car. Once inside, we can see that full-size DVD drive, hard drive and CPU cooler, and behind here you can find the memory, and this is the power supply. The hard disk is mounted in a plastic drive cage which can easily be removed. The disk in here was originally a 160GB SATA drive. Looks like this is a 200GB drive, which I probably put in here myself at some point. There are 4 pins on the side of the plastic drive cage that hold that drive in place. On one side, you can slightly bend the cage and get the drive out. The next big thing to remove is that DVD writer. First, we can lift up the cage holding it after pressing the blue button on the side. That gives us access to the cables. Then we can press that round button to release the drive and slide it out backwards from there. As you can see, there is another clip that holds the drive in place in the cage. So far, all of what we did was completely without any tools. And you can see that Lenovo did their homework on making it easy for a user to replace these components. Now that the drives are out, let me get the SATA cables out as well. Then we can take off that plastic fan duct to have better access to the rest of the components. As mentioned, only 4GB of RAM was currently installed. I'll try to upgrade that to 16GB, but as you will see later, that will eventually end up to be only 8. I also have a 120GB SSD here, which I will install in the machine. Now to continue our disassembly. Let me first remove the rest of the cables from the motherboard. I'm starting by removing the power input. And continue with case connectors like front LEDs, front USB, the front fan, front audio, the second serial port, PC speaker, and finally the thermal sensor for the hard drive. Since the motherboard is completely free now, we can remove the 8 screws that hold it in place and get it out of the case as well. At this point, the board wasn't really moving, so I thought that the CPU fan was also fixed to the back of the case, something you typically see with HP small form factor PCs, so I went ahead and got that one out as well. I can tell you for sure that thermal paste has seen better days here, and we'll take care of the much needed replacement for it when we put things back together. Getting the CPU fan out did help to get the motherboard loose, and at this point we can get it out of the case. Remaining here is the non-standard 240W ATX power supply. Now that the board is out and I cleaned up that old thermal paste from the CPU and the cooler as well, we can get it out of the socket. As we could see when looking up the serial, not so much on the video, the CPU installed is a Core i5-2400, a slightly slower CPU than the tower version which I tested before. We'll see how much of a difference that really makes in the benchmarks. Looking at the specifications, it looks like the only difference between both is the frequency, which is slightly higher for the i5-2500, so I expect the difference to be rather small. Upgrading the CPU here in the M91p is also an option. As far as I could find, an i7-2600 would be the fastest CPU that is supported. Enough about that CPU, let's have a better look at the motherboard instead. At first glance, this is not standard ATX, although I believe it might fit in an ATX case. First of all, we have the CPU socket and the four memory slots, labeled DIMM 1, 2, 3 and 4. To get maximum performance with dual channel, you should populate equal modules in pairs, starting with the blue slots first, then the green ones. Here we have the PCIe X16, PCIe X1 and two legacy PCI slots. ATX power connector and P4, CPU fan, system fan and power fan connectors, parallel port, second serial port, front audio, PC speaker, front USB, front LEDs and power button, 4 SATA ports, CMOS reset jumper, BIOS chip, and CMOS battery. On top here we also have the thermal sensor connector. And this one is for connecting PS2 ports for keyboard and mouse, if you would want that. We are ready to put everything back together, so first an overview of the components. We got the motherboard, the CPU, cooler, 4x8GB of DDR3, SSD, hard disk, DVD drive and the cage for that hard disk. We are starting with the Intel Core i5-2400, which we need to insert in the CPU socket on the motherboard. Then the memory. Since I got 4 equal DIMMs, or at least that's what I thought, we shouldn't need to bother about which slots to use. As I mentioned before, I thought that the CPU cooler got fixed on the case itself rather than on a backplate, but it seems I was wrong about that. So we can also put back the CPU cooler before putting the motherboard back in the case. Before that, I'll put a bit of fresh thermal paste, which was pretty welcome here. Then we can install the CPU cooler back on top of its CPU. While I wanted to put the motherboard back, I noticed this date stamp on the bottom of the case. So this got assembled about 11 years ago. Now that the motherboard is back in place, I'll get it fixed as well. Then we can connect everything back. I'll start with power. And after that, all case related connectors can be reconnected. This is my least favorite part, I guess, always has been. Now that is done, we can prepare the SATA cables for our DVD drive, hard disk, and SSD. The DVD drive is first, and we can simply slide it back in, as long as that bracket on the side is in place. There is very little room left between the drive and the power supply, so we can only use an angled SATA connector here. I found that out the hard way and had to change the cable in order to fix this. The SSD will be placed under the hard disk. I do need to split the power, as there is only two power connectors for drives available in the case by default. The hard disk gets connected as well, and then can be put back above the SSD. Last part to install is the plastic fan duct, which is fixed to the CPU cooler with two screws. And we're done here, so we can close up our computer by closing the hood. I got everything connected, so let's see if our reassembly was a success. I didn't really test the machine before all this, so let's hope all works fine. That's not a sound one likes to hear, I guess. Clearly something is wrong with the hard drive here. Also, it looks like the fans are spinning way too fast. When I took a look in the BIOS, I do see that the CPU and drives are there, but only 8GB of RAM. Well, okay, this gives us an indication that multiple things are really wrong here. First of all, that hard disk. I'll just remove it, as it's only 200GB and I guess it's already past its lifespan. The rest of the issues, like the loud fan noise and BIOS beeps, most likely have something to do with the memory that's not being detected. So that's where I will start with the troubleshooting. After testing and swapping with some of the modules, I quickly understood what was wrong here. Let me demonstrate. With these two identical DIMMs in slot 2 and 4, all seems to be working fine. With the other pair on the other hand, in the same slots, we do get those BIOS beep codes and nothing on the screen. Taking a closer look at the DIMMs that are not working shows us that these are in fact RDIMMs. Registered or buffered DIMMs are typically used for servers and almost never supported for desktop PCs. Looks like I just picked the wrong ones here. So as with the hard disk, I'll just leave them out as 8GB is actually a good match with the rest of the hardware and definitely fluent enough for today's usage. After doing all of this, the fan noise dropped to normal levels as well. Time to install Windows on the SSD, as there is no operating system yet. Once that is done, we can also install all updates, and after quite some patience, the system is ready to be tested. Let's start by taking a look at about this PC. Here we can see what we would expect, the i5-2400 and the 8GB of RAM. In Task Manager, we see exactly the same. Now to test performance, let's do a benchmark with Geekbench 5. $2,307 is not too bad. After all, don't forget that this PC is already around 11 years old now. If we compare it with the M91p tower that I tested, we can see that one scored slightly higher. This is completely what we would expect between an i5-2400, which is in this machine, and an i5-2500, which was in the other one. Now let's test the SSD as well. Almost exactly the same numbers as with the tower. Again, completely expected, as I did use the same model of SSD and the rest of the PC is largely similar. Final test that I will go through is Browser Bench, as this is probably a good benchmark for the specifications of this PC today. $102, again no surprise here, but it shows that although this is a rather old PC, it still is very comfortable for day-to-day office or web browsing tasks. That's all I have for this video. I really hope you enjoyed this time, and if you did, I'd appreciate a thumbs up. If you want more of the same, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel and enable notifications. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.